Thanks, Keith. So, good morning. I think most people know me, but my name's Alison and I will be leading this service. So welcome to everybody. And if it's your first time here, the toilets are down at the end to the right for the women's. Sorry, I can't get right from left, so I forget. And left on the other side of the corridor for the men's. So if I've got the wrong rights and lefts, then you can work it out, I'm sure. It's never been a particular skill of mine, I'm afraid. So this morning we will be thinking about our next phrase from the Lord's Prayer, forgive us our sins. So we're going to do, Tom will be preaching to us. Like, oh, there's Tom. Oh, that's good. Yeah, left, that's right. Thank you. I think it's probably too old to teach me rights and lefts. But never mind. And I will also be the pianist some of the time. So we'll see how that goes. So David says, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven and whose sins are covered. We're going to open our service now by singing Welcome, King of Kings.
Let's stand to sing and welcome the King of Kings, our Father. 1, 2, 3, 4.
So we're going to look at notices and also crunches, and I think the crunches is the most important thing, so we'll do that first. Has anybody had a birthday? Oh, yes. Okay. We won't ask you how old you are. I'm assuming it's 21 again.
Thank you very much.
Happy birthday. Anybody else? A new great-grandson. What's his name? Ronnie. Excellent.
We had a new car yesterday.
Well, that's nice too. We can try, yes. I had a new car the other week too. Anybody else? Any anniversaries? Anything particularly to celebrate? Yes.
My son passed the license for the aircraft mechanics.
Oh, very good. Aircraft mechanics. That's not easy, but very necessary. Thank you. So, notices. Stephen. Where's Stephen? Oh.
So as we are all aware, we're changing to a charity here at Beverley Baptist Church. We're in that transition right now. One of the practical things we have to do within that is to change our bank accounts. We have new bank accounts, and therefore I have got, just for you, some information about those bank accounts. I'd ask you, if you give to the church, if you could transfer your giving to the new bank account, ideally in the next few weeks, by April really, but if you can do it sooner rather than later. And with that, I'm just going to match that with, if you're a gift aid, if we can claim gift aid from you, there's a new gift aid form as well. The bank account details and the new gift aid forms are at the back on the table by the door. Thank you.
Thank you. And there's a church meeting next week, next Friday, next Sunday, after the service. So it's open to everybody. You don't have to be a member. And you should have had the details through email. Bring a packed lunch and we'll eat our lunch together before we have the meeting, so we don't get too hungry if it goes on, which it won't, I'm sure. Okay, so one of the things we do in our church is that we support various people who are working as missionaries, and we should have a slide which is going to come up. Lovely, thank you. And a missionary is a person who tells other people about Jesus. So we are all missionaries in our way, whether we are where we've always lived, or whether we have gone to a different community in this country, or whether we're overseas or whatever. But we're missionaries who tell people about Jesus through our lives, our work, and our words. We also support financially, a few people who work in different places, I'm going to give you an update on them now. Just for information, this will not appear on the recording which goes on to our website, because some of the people work in countries which are quite sensitive to this sort of thing. So let's start.
Towards preparing ourselves to hear what God's got to say to us about the Lord's Prayer this morning. Prayer that we offer up to our Father. Our Father, the one who is the King of Kings that we sang about earlier. Our Father, the one who is the Almighty God, the Creator God. Our Father, the one who is the giver of life to all things in this world and in the universe, if there is any more life out there. He's our Father. Let's stand to sing, Almighty Creator. Almighty Creator. Thank you. children leave us now, those of us who remain are going to continue in that idea of the love of God for us, so high and so wide and so deep. How deep the Father's love for us.
Chris comes to read to us, I have seen a new baby. So welcome Fiona and Reuben. And I look forward to a cuddle after the service. So Chris, thank you.
Today's reading is taken from Psalm 32, verses 1 to 7. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away. Through my groaning all day long, for night and day your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledge my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you. While you may be found, surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance.
Thank you. And Tom's going to come and share the word with us. So let's pray for Tom now. Father God, we thank you for Tom. Thank you for his ministry. And we thank you, Lord, for these words which he has prepared for us. We pray, Lord, that we will hear your voice through them, and we will listen and learn. Amen.
I come to you this morning with a great sense of fear and trembling and my inadequacy for this task of this teaching session. As I had an early breakfast and turned on the radio to hear the forecast, I was tempted to say, if you allow me to preach long enough, I can let you leave when the sun is shining. But there's something much more wonderful and hopeful than that. And that lovely passage is a magnificent psalm that we read in Psalm 32. And I just pray that sense of the blessing of forgiveness can be yours. Blessed is the one whose sins are forgiven, who is really at peace with God. That's my aim this morning. We're going to be looking at one of the phrases of this model prayer, the Lord's Prayer. And that's prayer of forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And as we do, I just pray that we'll not just get some intellectual ideas, maybe some insights that we might have missed, but much more experience, the peace, the forgiveness that we can only have through Jesus Christ. And I really pray that would be the experience of everyone this morning. May we pray. Well, Heavenly Father, as we come this morning to reflect on this one part of the Lord's Prayer, we claim the promise that our Lord Jesus gave us that he would pour on us his Holy Spirit and that Spirit would guide us into all truth. Father, we recognize that in our fallen state, we can hear and not understand. We can see but not perceive. And that so often we harden our hearts. So, Father, I pray that you pour out your Spirit and give us eyes that see with perception. Give us ears that hear with understanding. And as we listen, may we offer up our hearts to you and say, Lord, take me and continue to remake me and remold me after your will. And I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart may be pleasing and acceptable in thy sight and useful in your hands to this experience of profound peace, of forgiveness, and at oneness with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The phrase of the Lord's Prayer that we're looking at this morning begins with that word, forgive us of our sins. but I reckon you may have been confused by the various words that are used to translate the Greek behind that. And that's one of the reasons why it's good to have the Lord's Prayer up there when we're reciting it, because some translation says, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. I think that's the Authorized Version, and that's the one many of us grew up with reciting. Other verses say, forgive us our debts as we forgive those our debtors. And I reckon you could say, well, not many people owe me money, so I don't have to worry about that one. And then others say, forgive us of our sins. Well, what's it? Why this confusion of translation? Well, you see, the Old Testament was written in Hebrew, and the New Testament was written in Greek. And of course, Matthew is written originally in the Koine Greek, the marketplace Greek of the time of Jesus. And behind these words are the Greek, and in these phrases, and particularly the words that follow us, and Jesus, of all the phrases of the Lord's Prayer, Jesus only comments on one. Look at the Matthew, that after the prayer, he says, and indeed, get what I mean, you are to forgive as you have been forgiven. And not only that, you will be forgiven to the extent that you forgive others. That's a very harsh saying, and I won't give it the full time it deserves this morning, but a very harsh statement. And we look at that, and different words that are translated as sin are used, different words in these few passages, different Greek terms. And the Old Testament, too, has several Hebrew terms for sin. In all, there are about 414 times the English word sin appears in a certain concordance of the English Bible. And I say some of them do because different translators may put different words in there. So it's hard to give account all the terms that are used to translate as sin. But as I look at this, and one that will help us understand some of the nuances of this meaning, I find the most helpful is the Hebrew language, which I'm not an expert at all, but having to study a bit of Hebrew. Hebrew is a very picture language. And sin is really missing the mark. Missing the mark. Falling out of line, that's where we get this idea, forgive us our trespasses. God has given us some lines to live with, conducts to do. And then when we step out of them, we're trespassing God's law. Forgive us our debts. We are indebted because we have violated these ethical and moral principles. Really, the best term, I think, to communicate that is the term we so often use as sin. But now, in the Bible, sin is missing God's ideal. Can we go to the next slide? In the Bible, sin is missing God's ideal. We can't understand sin without understanding the root for whom we sin, and that is God's ideals, God's principles. I remember as a teenager looking at one of the most magnificent psalms of confession, and that Psalm 51. And the scholars look at it and says this must have happened to Jesus, to King David, after Nathan pointed out his sin against Bathsheba. And there's a strange line in that prayer of confession of King David. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict, and justified when you sin. You see, always emphasize that aspect. Against you, you only have I sinned. And you read about that terrible moral lapse, which began with adultery with Bathsheba. Then he tried to cover up. He tried to, Bathsheba's was alone at that time. Her husband was in battle. And by the way, he was one of King David's great generals. They list in the Second Chronicles and First Kings the great generals, and Bathsheba's husband is listed there. He called them back to try to cover up his misdemeanor, or awful moral lapse, and thought he would sleep with his wife and it would cover up that she was pregnant. But lo, you see, the Ark of the Covenant was with the army of God, and the soldiers had committed themselves to sort of this abstinence of several things, including sexual relationship, because the Ark of the Covenant was amidst them. And so, the name is slipping my mind now, this general refused to go to his wife because the Ark of the Covenant was with him, and he knew that he was just there as a messenger. And then, tries as he might, even to the point of giving him one more night to spend with his wife and intoxicating him a bit with some wine, still he kept true to that vow of abstinence, didn't even visit his wife. And now, this is what the King David, he takes another step, and then he sends this general back to Joab, the chief general, telling him to put in the front lines where he would be killed. So he killed one of his choice generals just to cover up his sin. And after doing all those terrible things, and it just goes from bad to worse, how could he say, against you, you only have I sinned? Because sin is breaking God's principles. You know, some people would have justified what King David did. You know, our moral compass is very weak. We do all have a moral compass, but we're fallen creatures, and it can't be relied upon. Sin is something we do against God. Let me give you one other illustration of this. One of the lovely Psalms, Psalm 119, is all a reflection of law, of the law, of God's principles. And the psalmist writes, very likely to be the same David, "I have hidden thy word in my heart that I might not sin against you." How do we know when we sin? Is by reflecting on God's laws, on God's ideal. And if you look, you know, amazing in the temptation of Jesus, the account that we have in Matthew. Jesus is right after his baptism, he's led into a period of testing in the desert. And we have an account of the interaction with Jesus and the evil one. And each time that the devil tries to tempt Jesus, how did Jesus refute him? By quoting scripture. He says, you're hungry, look at all these stones, just turn it into bread and satisfied. What does Jesus say? Quoting the Old Testament, man shall not live by bread alone. Each temptation was confronted with that hidden word in Jesus' heart. Now, we need to use the term sin with great sensitivity. Can we go to the next one? How the term sin is understood. I think there's a real difference in the way that we hear, particularly those that have attended worship service and know your Bibles and worship God. We do not take such offense at this word. You know, we've heard it so many times, and one thing, we identify with that. We remember what Paul said, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." And so, we identify as ourselves as sinners saved by God's grace and in need of forgiveness. We need this prayer, "Father, forgive us our sins." But what about the outsiders? How do people outside our bubble or circle of Christian community, how do they feel when they hear church leaders talk about sin? They very rapidly take great offense. Because what they hear us saying is, "I'm morally superior to you, and if you're engaging in this behavior, I'm right and you're wrong." They feel judged not by God, but by we who hold up God's ideals for our lives. So we need to be very, very sensitive how we use this term sin with the outsiders.
just a minute. There's a funny turn of a page here. Here we are. Is the term "forgive us our sins" enough? That's how that word begins. As a model prayer, as a reciting, as a group in a public worship service, it's the most appropriate term. Forgive us our sins. As we are in a group setting, we can't, as we say this prayer, then go on to recite our failings, our shortcomings, our sin. But if we use this prayer as an outline or as a model for our personal prayer, our personal devotion, I'm sure that it's not enough just to say, oh yes, Father, please forgive me my sins, and then go right on to other requests in our prayer. There's a real leak with sins, of saying forgive us our sins, and confession. And I hope if you take one verse today to memorize, you'd memorize this verse. If many of you already know it quite well, I know. 1 John 1:8-9. And it says this. This is the Apostle John writing. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. What we're asked to do is not say, Father, forgive us our sins, but to reflect, how have we disappointed our God? We've disappointed others too, but behind that, we've disappointed others primarily because we sought our own selfish ambitions and wishes. So we need to go beyond just that forgive us of our sins. And in our private devotional time, take time before the Lord and seek to confess our sins. Now I want to tell you, if we move on to the next one, confession is the most challenging spiritual exercise. Confession is amongst the most challenging spiritual exercise. Look what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, recorded for us in Matthew chapter 7, verses 4 and 5. How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all at the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. There is a place in our Christian community to correct brothers and sisters in Christ when they have a moral lapse. We're here for that accountability, for loving each other through the sin to forgiveness and the restored peace. But I want to place this truth. There's a phrase that I picked up in geometry or trigonometry called corollary. Well, you see, if this statement is true, then this is also true. Is that right? Is that the mathematical term? But anyway, if this statement is true, we can state it in another way with the same that depends upon this, derived from this truth that Jesus spoke. And I would say to you, it is so much easier to see the speck in your brother's eye than the plank in your own eye. Devil, nod in your head. Can you see what I mean? It's so much easier to see the speck in your brother's or sister's eye than the plank in your own. And I've had such terrible time in pastoral relationships and seeing the difficulty of seeing this plank in your own eye. May we give a context to this difficulty and the challenge of confession. I want us to go something from Galatians 6 for an insight of why this is such a challenge to us, of seeing the plank in our own eye. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the power of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces in the heavenly realms. We are engaged in a spiritual battle. We may not talk much about it. Curse us not to offend it, or curse us not to give praise to the evil one and his craftiness and his hard work. But we're against spiritual forces in heavenly places. We're no match for that. If we don't rely on what the Spirit instructs us and the strength that God gave us, we're in a hopeless battle. That's what it says. God wants us to walk humbly, to realize our limitations. Wisdom is to recognize our weaknesses and to see where we fall short. Jesus said this of the evil one in John 8:44. He, speaking of the devil was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When the devil lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of all lies. Other scriptures speak of the devil as the arch deceiver. As the arch deceiver. And he is very, very crafty. And in counseling some of the people, I see how crafty the evil one is. Because so often people that are engaged in grievous moral shortcomings can't see it themselves. This happened overseas, so don't try to think about the history of this church. But I'm sure something similar has happened. I was in a church where we had a person with real trouble with gossiping. Just a real natural at it. And it hurts the community so much. And so many people were, as we talked about our fellowship, would bring this up and how hurtful things this woman said. Because she came across as such a pious person. And so I go visit her. And I called her attention to the hurt that she was causing with her gossip. And you would think I called her some profane name. She was so adamant to say that she wasn't a gossiper. Not me, Pastor. What's happening? She didn't see what she did as gossip. The arch deceiver tricked her. She was blind to the plank in her own eye. And I've had experience again overseas, so don't try to connect the dots, of couples in the fellowship that were engaged in adultery. And people began to feel uneasiness. It's just, there's something wrong here, Pastor. And I can't blame them. I can't accuse them. But there's something not right about the relationship. And so I go not by myself, but with others to speak to these people. And to the women that involved, I asked my wife to go with me. I wouldn't make this trip on my own. So I took my partner in ministry with me. And as we laid out the suspicions, she just went in such a defensive mode. Again, not me, Pastor. I wouldn't think of doing something like that. And as I left, I said, I don't know what's happening here. Either she deserves a Grammy Award for acting, or she's deceived. And I've come to the conclusion, when she says she did not commit adultery, I could say the husband said the same thing, that both denied it. They were deceived. They defined adultery outside the parameters of their action, where anybody else in the world, not just much less the church family, would see, no, that's adultery. But they didn't see it. Satan is the arch deceiver. We need great humility to see the plank, and I'll put these two extremes out there. And you know what? I want to attach this to it. Though we're going to see that we're to confess our sins, I don't believe we're aware of all our sins. We too fall, not least to this extent of committing adultery or being a terrible gossip that really hurts people. But so much of our relationships with friends and families, we hurt each other. We're not aware of the hurts that we bring upon others by our thoughtless actions. How do we do this? Jesus promised that let's go to this help and confession. Let's go to how can we defeat the evil one? Jesus promises us that he has not left us as orphans. He has sent the Holy Spirit to enable us and strengthen us. He said to each one, and I hope we can take this home too, "Lo, I am with you always, even to the ends of the earth." Jesus has not left us helpless against the arch deceiver. And then there's this other beautiful, beautiful prayer, also in the Psalms. And the prayer goes this way: "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thought. See if there's any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." That's the most beautiful, humble prayer to introduce our time of confession. We need to realize that we often fail to see the plank in our eyes, much less the speck in there. And Jesus told his disciples that he would send the Holy Spirit that would, you know, convict us of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. It is the Spirit that brings us awareness that we're outside of the bounds of God's will and perfect plan for us. How we need much humility in this area. And then one more challenge at this place. It doesn't only say, "Forgive us of our sins as we forgive those who sin against us." I wish the second phrase hadn't been in there. I wish that all we had to do was just ask God's forgiveness. And then he turns around and says, "Wait a minute. The forgiveness you'll experience is related to the willingness that you forgive others." How can we get around this one? One suggestion is that we all need grace. Insiders and outsiders of our community, we all need grace. You know, not all types of sin and missing God's ideals have equal condemnation in our society. And one of the deceiving tricks of the evil one is to, if we start feeling bad, call our attention to somebody else who's even worse. Okay, that's one of the tricks he uses. "You're not bad. Look at your neighbor. Look at your spouse," or you know how it can go. we divert attention from seeing our shortcomings. But if we were to use the world's criteria of goodness and badness, for every human being on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 for those people who, you know, like Hitler, you know, that not just sin but cause havoc upon so many, many people. And you can name other political leaders that just massacred their own population, like in Cambodia, that tried economic reforms that just brought, just devastated that country. Surely those are the big sinners, to call them one. But then let's look, there's also people with outstanding moral traits that are pillars in the community, that are regarded not as sinless perfection, but as models, people to look up to. And that's not just people of faith. People that don't claim it can also live exemplary moral lives. And then we can think of even positive examples. Mother Teresa, for instance. You don't have to be a Catholic to appreciate what she does. She was such a moral example that she was a witness to the world and upheld her ministry with the poorest of the poor in India. But you know what? whether Hitler at the bottom, some other figure like Mother Teresa at the top of our moral scale, all still need God's grace. We all need grace. We can't pull up ourselves by our bootstraps. We're dependent on the grace of God. And as we are ourselves, wherever you put yourself on that scale, and I don't think anybody would put themselves lower than 2, you know, wherever you are on that scale, you still need grace. And because we've received grace, we need to reflect this grace. We need to build a gracious, forgiving community. Yes, we need to make clear the ideals and designs of God, but not in the way that condemns, but in the way that redeems. We all know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. But then he goes on to say, for the Son of Man came not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. In setting forth God's ideal, we are not condemning those who missed it, because we're amongst those who've missed it too. But there is hope. Jesus came to redeem us in our place. Abounding grace. We see that so beautiful in the woman by the well of Samaria, Sychar, who fell so short of the biblical ideal of marriage and even the secular ideal of marriage in her day. She was an outcast in that town. She'd been married 5 times before, and she was living with somebody that she didn't even bother to get legally married to. And yet Jesus treated her with such respect, with such dignity, with such love. He poured out his grace on her. She did not feel condemned by him. She felt valued by him, and feeling that value, she gained the strength from above to try to address the situation. The same could be said with Matthew. Matthew was a tax collector. He was loathed by the majority of the Jewish people of his day because he's in collusion with the Romans and making himself rich at their own people, by the Jewish people that he was taxing, lining his pockets, pleasing the government, making himself rich at the cost of his own people. He was loathed. And Jesus saw him and called him from the tax office. He left everything to follow him. Jesus didn't go condemning him for his betrayal of his own people. Jesus showed grace and love. And we are called to do the same as a Christian community. Finally, may I ask, how do you react to the word sin? I told you that differences of the insiders and outsiders, how we identify ourselves as sinner and don't take such offense. But many people in our places, and maybe some here, feel threatened by the word sin. How can we be at peace because of what Jesus Christ did for us? The Bible tells us that as he died on the cross, the perfect sacrifice, the sinless Lamb of God, suffered in our state, took upon himself the punishment that we deserve for our sins, and can say to us, my son or my daughter, your sins are forgiven. And as we talk about forgive us of our sins, I want you to feel that peace that comes from understanding that perfect forgiveness and pardon that Jesus offers all who place their faith in him. As I think of that, I think of some hymns that are out of vogue right now for their very graphic imagery. But I remember that sin, what can wash my sin away? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. We have peace because we have a confidence in the efficacy of the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that love poured out gives us the strength to look at our own shortcomings where we've missed the mark and find peace because we trust what he did for us to make peace with God. And we can live in peace with God. And that is my prayer, that each one of us, no matter how many years you've thought to follow Christ, or if you're still in that stage of exploring your faith and trying to make sense of it all, I pray that you'll experience the faith, experience the peace that only Jesus can offer. That we cannot shy away from confessing our sins and knowing that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, will forgive us all our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Amen.
Thank you, Tom. That was really helpful. So we're going to have a time of reflective prayer. But before we do that, I just want to remind you that after our service, if you would like to talk to somebody or pray with somebody, some of the leadership team are here, or the person that you came with, or somebody you know, but don't leave the opportunity, or Tom, to talk or pray with somebody.
So yes, let's just be quiet and use this time. You use this time for yourself. Okay, this is your little bit among the us part. How has God spoken or challenged you through what we've heard today? We're going to use the prayer that Tom had in his sermon, Psalm 139, the last two verses in there. Search me, O God, and know my heart. We'll take that short prayer line by line and think about it and pray about it. And you just go with what you need to go with to draw close to God and to reconcile yourself with him and think about the plank in your eye. Psalm 139. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way. Search me, O God, and know my heart.
The human heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it?
Father God, I know that you already know me better than I know myself, but I invite you to search me, to look into my heart, and to help me to see what hides there. test me and know my anxious thoughts.
Who among men knows the thoughts of man except his own spirit within him? But you discern my thoughts from afar.
Father God, I invite you to test me, to examine my limitations and help me to discover what concerns and fears there are that constrain and limit and control me. And see if there's any offensive way in me.
A person may think their own ways are right, but the Lord weighs the heart. To do what is right and just is more acceptable to the Lord than sacrifice.
Father God, expose those places in my heart and mind that I hide even from myself. Help me to recognize and get to grips with all that does not please you. Then lead me in the way everlasting.
Small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Follow me.
Loving Father, you know all my shortcomings and yet you love me with an everlasting love. As I continue along the path that lies before me, help me to follow Jesus, always keeping in step with your guiding spirit. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way.
Hi. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. We're going to finish with a song, but before then I'd been asked to remind you that a week on Wednesday we have the next TAC talk, Can Mindfulness Be a Pathway to God, with Dr. Roger Brotherton. So Nigel is here and can tell you more, and I'm sure there are these around as well. It should be really good, so thank you.
So our final song this morning is a hymn that we all know and love, I'm sure. It takes us on from our sin and confession of our sin to recognizing the confession of our sin. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Saviour's love? Yeah, let's stand to sing.
Thank you.
tea and coffee is being served, and don't forget, if you want to talk to somebody before you leave, then please do. Have a good week.